And welcome to the Saturday morning wake-up call right here on KFAR. It's local talk radio, but we are streaming live around the world at KFAR660.com. There's also a chat room there if you'd like to jump in and sound off electronically this morning. This show is about liberty. It's about the founding fathers. It's about the documents that are supposed to preserve the government that was founded. kind of interesting. Say again, Josh.
Preserved it was.
Preserved it was. Josh Bennett, one of our sponsors here this morning from Bighorn Enterprises. The other sponsor in the studio here with us this morning, Aaron Bennett from Far North Tactical.
And give a shout out to Frank Turney today. He actually sponsored the show today. Thank you, Frank Turney.
Beautiful.
Thank you, Frank.
And we are here basically for one reason and one reason only, and that is to try to wake up as many people as we possibly can to what is going on. Josh, take it away.
I've just, everyone's in a big hubbub this week over the Supreme Court ruling with the Obamacare, so-called Obamacare, national health care, basically. And I kind of look at it a little bit differently. I think that we have another constitutional victory. The Supreme Court upheld the Constitution, saying that Congress has the right to tax. And guess what, folks? They do. I got a friend of mine posted something on Facebook, and he said, apparently now we are told that we can no longer say we don't want what you're selling. Well, guess what? That happened a long time ago. That happened in the War of the States when the South tried to secede because they told the federal government, we no longer want what you're selling. The federal government said, you have no choice. You may not secede. Well, folks, don't get in a big hubbub and start crying about this ruling because democracy was upheld. The Constitution was upheld. All the conservatives out there that whine about judicial legislation from the bench, well, guess what? They didn't legislate from the bench. In fact, Roberts actually said that. He said, it's not my job to legislate from the bench. He said, that's Congress's job to make laws. Said, and he also pointed out something. I'm going to chop this up because I don't have the quote in front of me, but he basically said, it's not our job to fix the political follies of the people. If the people don't like it, they can throw the bums out, supposedly. But don't ask the Supreme Court to do it. You voted them in. This is what the people wanted. This is what the people asked for. You got what you deserve. And I thought he did a really good job talking about the Commerce Clause, that Congress does not, I mean, this is like the first time ever that the Supreme Court said that the Congress can't use something on the Commerce Clause. And then he came back and said, but they do have the right to tax. And that's how the Obama administration fought the case. They said, this is just a tax. The individual mandate's a tax. And Congress has the unmitigated authority to tax whatever they want. I mean, I'm reading blogs and stuff, and I'm going, oh, this means they can tax you to do anything. Go to church and wipe your rear. And exactly. Congress has the right to tax anything they want to.
Point out a couple of them really quick. If you go get a tan right now, there's like a $3 charge on top of your tan because of Obamacare. It's a tax.
Well, the thing about the church deal, they say, well, they can tax you to go to church. They already can, unless you go get one of their permits.
Right.
They'll tax you to be a church.
If you don't get a 501c3, you get taxed.
Yeah, so I don't really understand why people are all upset. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, the Constitution was upheld. So deal with it, folks. This is what you want. This is what you get. And the Constitution not only couldn't stop it, it actually upheld it, according to the Supreme Court justice. And guess what? Roberts was appointed by Bush. And I remember all the conservatives and neocons shouting and waving the flag and saying, finally a victory, this is the smartest. I mean, they said he was one of the smartest constitutionalist jurists ever, constitutional jurist ever to be sitting on the court. So, if he is one of the smartest jurists ever to sit on the Supreme Court, bingo, he must know what he's talking about.
Yeah, you see, I think this is also revealing that part of the issue here is that an awful lot of people that call themselves conservatives are really, they're just interested in forcing people to do things their way. And some of them are upset that the court didn't side with them to go out and force people to do things their way. I mean, it's like the folks who are calling Justice Roberts a turncoat or a traitor It's because he did not rule to shove the Republican form down everybody's throat, just the way that the health care was shoved down everybody's throat. It's like, look, this is part of the danger of democracy.
This is democracy.
You get enough people that are loud enough that are on your side, you can get pretty much anything you want to. And all we are told over and over again is, well, next time, just make sure you elect the right people.
Oh, yeah, we're already seeing that, where Romney's saying, you vote me in, I'm going to repeal this thing. Go ahead, Aaron, I know you're itching to talk about
that. Yeah, I am itching to talk about the fact that Mitt Romney's just switched his platform to run on the platform of, I will repeal Obamacare, and anybody with 2 cents of brain knows that Obamacare was just a copy off of Romneycare.
Yeah, I mean, what a freaking joke! Romneycare! Mitt Romney, he's the one that invented the whole stinking thing. And all you conservatives are going to shout, we got to get Mitt in there so we can reverse Obamacare and stop the destruction. What? Eee. How stupid can you be? Seriously. Mitt Romney, the guy invented Obamacare. It was like you just cut and paste and put Obama's picture and name on top and say, hey, there you go. Sweet. And now it's, well, guess what? If Mitt Romney was a president and he passed the Romneycare, all the conservatives would be chanting and marching in the streets about how we finally took care of the health care problem. It's a joke. I can't believe people are so stupid.
I'm really bothered by it. Yeah.
The Constitution was upheld. This is what democracy is all about. This is what our Constitution is all about. Congress, anyone can call in here and try to tell us that Congress does not have the right to tax whatever they want. Bull crap. Yes, they do. And the Supreme Court just upheld that. Yeah. They always have had that.
The coolest thing about Obamacare and the fact that it is a tax is they tax you either way. So if you absolutely decide that you are going to opt out of Obamacare, then you have to pay a tax. Isn't that the greatest part?
If you don't want it, you pay a tax. If you do want it, you pay a tax.
What I love about it is, just on a purely practical level, this accelerates the train heading toward the spot that we all know is going to go off the tracks.
Yeah.
Because at this point, we all know that this is going to force more people into the government healthcare system.
Oh, it's going to hurt.
It is going to force the more and more doctors not to be able to afford to stay in practice. It's going to force more and more public money to be extracted from somewhere in order to pay for all of these services, which now are mandated to be paid for because of all the people entering into the roles. And we are going to be accelerated on the path to what Greece is going through right now.
Oh, yeah, we're on the train.
Well, they're already, it's already affecting our lives in a whole bunch of ways that people are just now starting to notice. Look at how many things immediately got taxed, got a tax added onto them. Like I tried to say there, or started to say there a minute ago, just going to get a tan. Anything that has anything to do with health is being taxed. Even stripper poles in strip clubs are being taxed. Now, you get charged if you go into a strip club, you get charged at the door an extra $5 or something.
Why do you always know these things?
Because our brother Nate, who happens to be in here, just informed me of that.
That's weird.
Nate. Jeez.
Anyway,
all right. Well, we do have a
digressing there, but the whole point is that this is exactly what this democracy is about. There is no protection for the people. That was decided. The Hamiltonians have finally won. Jeffersonians, you're done, right? Revolution's over. Liberty is gone it's been gone for a long time. But like I said, back in the Civil War, when some of the people said, "We don't want what you're selling." A certain number of the states who had a guarantee that they could secede at any time. And the federal government said, no, you may not. Well, here it is again. We're just whining about something that was decided 160 years ago. You may not secede. You will do what we say. You will buy what we're selling, or we will kill you. I've been hearing people talking about how, well, it's not going to be enforceable, so it's kind of ridiculous. Bull. It's the IRS. You think it's not enforceable? Don't pay your taxes. This is no different. Don't sign your little deal on your 1040 form saying that you didn't get Obamacare.
What happens if you don't pay your taxes?
On your door.
Exactly.
And they're going to take your door and take your house and maybe shoot you or put you in jail with Lonnie Vernon. That's what they're going to do. So, yeah, it is totally enforceable. They've already got 15,000 new IRS agents to enforce it. So don't sit there and kid yourself that it's not enforceable. And don't kid yourself that you're going to vote in a bunch of Republicans to repeal it, because they'll put in their own crap. Because Mitt Romney invented it. And the Republicans invented the Patriot Act. And the Republicans invented the NDAA. Or, well, not necessarily the National Defense Authorization Act, but they invented the Detention Act. So good luck, folks. So have at her.
How many countries in the world have had indefinite detention? You just kind of sparked me to think for a moment.
Zero.
Indefinite detention?
Oh, well, yeah, I guess there were. There was Soviet Union. You could be indefinitely detained. There was Nazi Germany. You could be definitely detained.
Mao's China.
Oh, yeah, you could be definitely detained. Oh, you know one that was not? When we were colonies and we had King George as our king, you could not be indefinitely detained. Britain was the most free country in the world at the time. They had a Bill of Rights. They didn't have a Bill of Rights that you went down and you could go to whatever and look at it. It was just a known Bill of Rights. They didn't have to put it on a piece of paper because for hundreds of years they knew these are our rights as British citizens. And the colonists didn't even like that because there were things that the king did that pissed them off. Like they hauled them off to different places to try them or whatever. But you couldn't be indefinitely detained. But this greatest beacon of freedom standing on top of the hill for all to see, bring me your whatevers, bring me your people so I can detain them and tax them indefinitely. That's what it is. And guess what? That's what we want, and that's what you're going to vote for November 2nd of this year, whatever day it is. You're going to vote for more national detention, more national taxes, more Obama-Romney care, more. Well, have at it.
All of the talking heads are just, they're beating the drum. It's the same drumbeat over and over and over again. Get out the vote. Get out the vote. Yeah. Get out the vote. It's like, do you really think that's going to change anything? Is that going to make it any better? Are we going to be able to positively affect the future by getting out the vote?
Yeah, it'll definitely be affected.
I want to know how many times in my life, I'm 33 now, I think it's been every 4 years of my life I hear about how this is the most important election in history.
Yeah, that is awesome. Every 4 years.
This is the most important
one. Sean Hannity. Folks, it's the most important election.
Oh, I don't know. Glenn
lifetime.
Beck's just as bad. I mean, oh, yeah. Glenn Beck might even be worse at this point.
Glenn's
especially
getting
with
after
his
it.
Bashing on Ron Paul nonstop.
What a joke. That joke's coming to Fairbanks, too. I'm going to go protest him.
did he already come? Or is he
no, coming? He's coming in September. We're giving away tickets here on the radio station.
Neocon Joker.
That you have to give him away. No one will buy it.
Oh, snap.
That guy's such a joker. Everything that he talks about is so full of crap because in the same breath he promotes what's going on. Anyways, I think that you could probably give a constitutional, quote-unquote, argument. Original intent, Hamilton, this is exactly what Hamilton wanted. He wanted a strong national government. He wanted a central government, a national government. And that's what we have. Like I said, the Hamiltonians have won. The Jeffersonians have finally been completely. They were defeated a long time ago. But at least we can say, yeah.
Have they been exterminated?
No, they're not exterminated. There is a remnant of the Jeffersonians out there, the revolutionaries.
We were talking to one
this morning. His name's Frank Turney.
I'm revealing my Star Wars nerd, my inner Star Wars nerd, but all I can think of right now is when the Emperor went out and had all of the Jedi Knights cleansed from the from the Empire. You know, it had been a republic, and now it was becoming an empire, and what he had to do is he had to get rid of all the Jedi Knights, and he went out and exterminated all of the Jedi. I feel like that's what's going on right now, the Jeffersonians being exterminated. There might be a few survivors out in the system of Dagobah or something.
Well, if you follow the Star Wars movies, what happened was they had a republic that he turned into a democracy that turned into a dictatorship.
That is so strangely familiar, except I don't have a lightsaber.
So dies the republic to the sound of thunderous applause.
Yeah. Yeah, we could debate this thing for a long time, whether, I mean, the original intent of the Constitution versus now. I mean, basically, what Henry fought for, and some of the other Virginians, was basically, if you don't have the right to secede, which we've talked about a lot, if you don't have the right to secede, you're screwed. You're a slave. right? If you can't say no, you're a slave. That was something that the colonists, that the revolutionaries actually, I read this thing the other day about, and it was really pretty awesome. Even though they had slaves, it was part of their, part of the deal then, was they had slaves and they saw how they lived, right? They had no freedom. And so it's kind of ironic because when they were writing these things about the King George and the way he was treating them, they were basically saying, we have become slaves. We're just like our slaves now. And they didn't want that. So they fought a revolution over it. And here we are. We are no different than, and I don't want to get any people calling saying, how dare you? You're just like, I'm not saying we're like the slave, the plantation slaves. No. But our freedom is done. These guys have opened. I don't agree with Obamacare. The government, I don't think, should be able to force you. I don't even think there should be a government. But they shouldn't definitely not be able to force you to do anything. The only thing they're supposed to do is protect private property. But they have to steal your property to protect it. So that doesn't work out too good. But what we have is slavery. Mm-hmm. You must do what they say, or they will whip you, beat you, throw you in jail, put a gun to your head, and blow your head off. You will obey, slave.
Frederick Douglass was a black statesman from the 1800s who was born a slave, and I think he said it best. He said, I did not know I was a slave until I found out I couldn't do the things that I wanted to do.
Which, you could also turn that around and say, I did not know I was a slave until I was forced to do that I did not want to do.
Right, which would be the same thing. It would go against the will of what he wanted to do.
Which is what we have right now. You're being forced to do that which you do not wish to participate in. 20 million people, I think.
So if Frederick Douglass identified himself with being a slave once he figured out that he couldn't do the things that he wanted to do, then how come we can't figure out that we're all slaves?
Because we get to vote in 2 months or 3 months or whatever it is. Oh. That's why.
Well, we also have the option with this system of making other people our slaves.
Yeah.
I mean, this is you pointed out, Josh, that the very slaveholders in the South were trying to preserve their own freedom, recognizing that they were being made slaves by the king and wanting to preserve their own freedom, and had yet somehow had this disconnect where they didn't see anything wrong with keeping their own slaves.
Right.
And you see it here in our political system right now. You've got the Democrats right now are sitting in the place of power that have the Republicans crying and screaming and saying, freedom, only so that they can turn around in November and force the Democrats back into chains.
Yep.
Because that's exactly what's been happening, hasn't it? Over the
last at least
50 years or so, we've been doing this back and forth. You get in our chains, now we'll get in your chains, now you get in our chains again. And it's just, at some point, we have to be willing to say, I'm not going to force you into chains.
Yeah. Jefferson actually thought that we'd have, and probably you could imagine at the time the way things were in the 1770s or whatever, he assumed we'd have a revolution every 20 years or so, because he thought, these people are pissed. They're going to stay this way. They're never going to let this happen again. They're never going to let anything encroach on their freedom. What he didn't understand was, once people figured out they could vote, and you had politicians who have been able to manipulate that to the point where they're saying, yeah, don't have a revolt, don't have a revolution. You can vote us in next time.
Well, we have a revolution every 4 years, right?
Yeah, that's what they keep telling
you. Yeah, mm-hmm. Right. Every time. Yeah, every time they have
the revolution. I remember when Obama first got elected, 2 years later, we were told that it was the most critical and pivotal election of all time. History would show that it was the most critical election ever.
Yeah, we had the freedom revolution when we had the midterm elections. What a joke. I mean, if that was a revolution, when they voted in a few people into the House, ooh, we really are screwed.
That's just, we've got some very, very weak cheese going on.
We just got to get Romney in there, Josh.
Yeah, Mitt Romney. I can't believe that it's come down to the savior of the world, the free nation, is going to be Mitt Romney. Instead of people sitting back and saying, Mitt Romney is not the solution to this. Congress is not the solution. The R, the D, I'm the solution. And, you know, we do have a choice when we say, you know, we have to buy what they're selling. We don't really. But they will kill us. So we are slaves, unless enough of us decide that we want to be revolutionaries, and we say, no, we're not buying what you're selling. We're done. I mean, the greatest thing that could happen this coming election is not to get out the vote and everyone goes down there and it's the greatest election ever and the most people who ever voted in history, because all that does is legitimize the crap that they pass afterwards. Right? How can you get mad about what Obama does? He was elected by a majority of the people. The people put him there. He's just doing what he's told. He's doing his job. Democracy, baby. So the greatest thing that happened, instead of legitimizing Romney by letting him get in, or legitimizing Obama by giving him a second term, is to not go and vote at all. If none of us went down there and didn't vote, what kind of election would that be? Well, we just had four people vote. That actually
happened Mitt in Romney? Ketchikan this week, right here in Alaska. They had an election down there on bonding. So they're talking about taking everybody's money to go out and bond for harbor improvements down in Ketchikan. A grand total of 237 people showed up for the vote. 7%.
Nice.
7% voter turnout. And, hey, surprisingly enough, the harbor bond passed, which means that now everybody, all the other 93% that didn't show up, they're going to get taxed extra for those harbor improvements.
That's the thing. You have to go the next step. When you decide you're not going to participate in that, then when it gets passed and shoved on you anyways, the majority didn't vote for it, then the majority should say, we're not paying the tax. There's the next step.
I want to tell a quick funny story. That
how funny is it?
Yeah, I think it's pretty it's pretty applicable. Carthage, when Rome was knocking on their gates and
that is funny.
Oh, sorry.
When Rome was taking over the city of Carthage, they put up almost no defense at all, and Carthage military wise was twice what Rome was. They could easily stopped what was happening, but it was mid stride of one of their biggest elections during Rome's invasion, and they couldn't muster up a defense against Rome because they were so embroiled and engulfed in their political fighting back and forth over who was going to get elected. So, like, you had all the harbor, you had all the longshoremen, which played a big role there, all getting together trying to sway the vote their way, and you had all the shopkeeper type people trying to sway the vote their way, so on and so forth. But if you look at what happened, how Rome was able to take him over, is because democracy was so embroiled in the way that they lived their life that they didn't even pay attention to the fact that their city was getting sacked because the elections were so important to them.
They must have had Sean Hannity back then too.
They must have.
Well, I'm just
trying to point out look at how insane people become over elections.
Yeah, a false sense of security too. I mean, it's so aggravating. The greatest thing that could happen is that we find out that only four people voted. Mitt Romney and his wife voted for him, and Obama and his wife voted for Obama, which I could go either way. I mean, you might actually have Mitt's wife vote for Obama. Who knows? That would be success.
She might if she gets confused over which one passed the health care.
Who was first? That would be success. That would be revolutionary. This voting for change, the revolution is on, and blah, 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 that is not change. That is the same old, status quo bondage. And you're voting for your own slavery. That's what I can't stand. That's what drives me nuts. You're voting for your own slavery. And people say, well, if you don't vote, then you can't complain. Bull. It's the exact opposite. If you voted, then you're the one that I should be griping at, because you're the one that put them in. Who has been voted in that hasn't taken my rights away or tried to? Who has been voted in that hasn't pointed a gun at my head and said, you must bow or else? And the people that vote for those people, they're the ones to blame. Not me, because I didn't vote. I've never voted in a presidential election. I've never voted in any election except for a couple of the borough ones here when I was running. I had to vote for myself.
I voted for you.
Oh, I voted for you too. Anyways, the whole point of it is, it's not the people that don't vote that should be blamed. you jerks that are voting these guys in to point guns at my head, it's your fault.
All right, we'll be right back with more of the Saturday Morning Wake Up Call right here on KFAR. It's local talk radio. All right, welcome back to the Saturday Morning Wake Up Call right here on KFAR. I'm the man with the face made for radio, Steve Floyd, just here pretty much to make sure that we stay on the air and we don't have a complete total meltdown of the circuits. On the other side of the board this morning, we've got Aaron Bennett from Far North Tactical. If you would like to get prepared for the zombie apocalypse, Aaron can help you out with that over there.
How's it going, Aaron?
And also from Big Horn Enterprises, the other sponsor, we've got Josh Bennett. And when performance matters, you call the folks over there at Big Horn Enterprises. Good morning, Josh.
Good morning.
We also got Nate Bennett here.
He's lurking. He's
throwing any dirt at him.
He's not. What if I'm a monkey and I want to throw something else?
He's just sitting over there making faces.
All right. We've got all of our lines on hold. Would you like to see what the people...
Hello. Hello.
There we go.
Would you like to see what the people have to say this morning?
Yeah.
I am somewhat awake over here.
458 Talk is the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
Good morning, gentlemen. This is Mark.
Mark, go ahead.
Yeah, I recently had a medical experience here in Fairbanks. I crushed my heel and went to the emergency room. And for $2,000, I got an x-ray and a couple of ace bandages. And I was told to go see a doc on Monday, and doc wouldn't see me because I didn't have insurance. Now I'm being punished for crimes of omission rather than for crimes of commission.
Welcome to America.
Sieg Heil.
Yeah, no joke.
Hasn't it been that way, though? I mean, if you think about it, right now, how many people are arrested because of the things they might do? You go out and you have too many drinks, and you get pulled over. You haven't actually hurt anybody or caused any damage, but because you might.
Well, when, you know, the people all went before Samuel and said, give us a king like all the other heathen nations do.
Yep. And exactly.
We all know the answer there, yep. And now God's not going to hear us when you're crying out about this godless heathen demos cretine mob rule thing we got going on.
Hey, it's just like Robert said, you got what you wanted. This is what the people wanted. I mean, that's what he said in his brief or whatever.
I'm not so sure that Roberts is as smart as Chief Justice Black or Holmes, but I concur with how Roberts ruled. I think he did his job.
Yeah, I do too. I think he did his job exactly as the Constitution told him. And I think that it's pretty funny because, you know, the people are screaming and yelling about it, but how many times have you heard the political right say, you know, we don't want legislation from the bench? We don't want activist judges on there telling us what the laws are going to be, blah, blah, blah. Well, Robert said, yeah, you're right.
And actually, part of the majority opinion said specifically, we are not going to decide whether or not this tax is right or wrong.
Right.
But they had the power to make the tax. According to the Constitution, this is a tax.
You have the power to do that.
They had the power to do that, and that's what we're ruling, that this is constitutional.
Yeah, and they flat out said, it's not our job to make law. That's Congress's job, and the people vote Congress in, and they have the right to throw them out.
Are you saying that Congress passed Obamacare?
I believe it.
Wait a minute. I thought it was
a whole bunch of people voted for it, and then they're like, well, we didn't know what was in it. Because, like the idiots they are, they didn't read it before they voted for it.
Well, gentlemen, I would say to you, peace be under this house, and remember, the good get better and the bad get worse. I'm out here.
Thanks, Mark. Appreciate it.
How can we blame Obama for Obamacare anyway if the Congress voted it in?
Yeah. Well, that's just the way we do things, Aaron. It's just like, you know, this whole thing with what Mark was just talking about, well, it cost him $2,000, the guy's not going to see him because he doesn't have insurance. Everyone's saying, well, we obviously need healthcare reform. The only healthcare reform we need is for the government to get out of healthcare, and it's instantly reformed.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, things aren't going to cost as much as it does.
What is the biggest expense in the healthcare industry?
Insurance.
From whom or for whom?
Non-insured people from the government?
No, that is not the biggest cost.
Oh.
The biggest cost in healthcare insurance is what the doctors have to pay
for
malpractice.
Malpractice suits.
And the reason why everything else costs so much is because the doctors have to pay so much to insure themselves against getting sued by people who say, you didn't treat me right.
Well, in the old days, I mean, if anyone who watched Little House on the Prairie knows this, that he had Mr. Doc Baker there, and he went and did his deal or whatever, and if he couldn't pay, you gave him a chicken or a cow or whatever it was, and you bartered, whatever. And things were fairly cheap then. The only reason that it got expensive is because the government put their foot in and said, we need to be involved in healthcare. We need to be involved in doctors and patients. They're the reason that it costs so much. They're the reason that we have to have insurance. So healthcare reform would be to eliminate the government from healthcare. And then it would be reformed. And let the free market take care of it. And guess what, people? It happened for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. And only since we've decided to put the government's foot in it,
but wait,
that it costs us what it does
didn't
now.
Didn't all of the poor people die because they couldn't afford health insurance?
Droves.
Well, let me throw a good example, I think, of that. So Nathan and I are over paving Cushman right now.
Right this minute?
Well, we were a half hour ago. We were doing the night shift. But the funny thing that we noticed about that job is for every one guy working, there's two guys. Well, I mean, technically they're working, but there's two guys
fired.
Not really doing a whole lot. And so you have one guy there testing compaction, one guy there testing the heat, one guy testing quality control, one guy grabbing the tickets to check the loads, and so on and so forth. Those are all state guys to make sure the HC, who's been doing roads for God knows how long and always done a good job, to make sure that they're doing a good job. And then you have flaggers on each corner, plus quality control on them, but those are state-imposed also. So probably two-thirds of the employees that are working there are all state-mandated. So how much more did that road cost us out of the state coffers for the state regulation on it?
Yeah, not to mention how many state guys are standing there watching the whole thing.
Three.
Uh-huh.
Three of them that are just observing.
Observation.
And it's a good thing, too, because if you weren't watched, I know how you are. You can't be left alone.
Well, I guarantee you that was reflected in the bid, that all of those extra people were going to have to be there.
Yeah.
So pretty much for every one guy that's actually working there that was part of the original bid, that was the labor bid, they had to add on two more for state control.
Hey, I was just thinking of something. You're right. But I was just thinking about Medicaid. Pretty sure they said that the federal government cannot force the state to up the Medicaid thing and withhold funds from them from the previous Medicaid law, Medicare, Medicaid. So it's going to be interesting to see what our state decides to do, whether they're going to expand Medicare, Medicaid here in the state and have... The Supreme Court said they can't take the money from them because the bait was, well, if you don't take this Medicare, Medicaid expansion, then we'll take the money away from all of your Medicare and Medicaid. And the Supreme Court said, no, you can't do that. You've already mandated that. And you've already promised that you'll pay it. So you can't take it away in passing. Just like, well, now we're going to change the rules, even though they can actually do whatever they want.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be interesting to see what our state decides to do, which I'm pretty much sure I know what our state's going to do. Bow down and lick the hands that feed them. Every time. Every stinking...
Well, how many individuals time. Are going to do the same thing? It's like, oh, man, now we've got this law that I don't agree with, and I really think it's wrong, but hey, now it's the law, so I'm going to go ahead and comply.
I don't fault people as much for that they're going to have to comply because they'll get shot in the head. What pisses me off is people are going to go vote and get the same thing, go right back in there, so they can pass laws to shoot me in the head. I mean, that's all it comes down to. You keep going down to vote for people that want to shoot you in the head.
It just depends on who's going to shoot you in the head. I mean, wouldn't you rather have a Republican shoot you in the head than a Democrat?
No. I don't want a Libertarian shooting me in the head. I don't want a Republican shooting me in the head. I don't want Ron Paul to shoot me in the head. I don't want anyone to shoot me in the head.
Josh, you have to choose between a concentration camp and a gulag.
Oh, so I get fascism or socialism? Dang it.
Wait, they're both.
Oh, socialism.
Wait a minute. You guys ready to go back to the phones?
Yeah.
458 Talk is the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
Hi, this is Donna.
Donna, go ahead.
And you know what? I would have turned you guys off, except you said so much stuff that irritated me. I had to sit on this stupid phone and listen to you.
Nice.
I have so many questions, and I'll go fast because I know time is of the essence. First question is, Who in the Sam Hill is this guest you have on your show this morning?
We don't have any guests.
This is the show, Donna.
Oh, who is the guy that is so anti-American, anti-Alaskan, anti-people, who doesn't ever vote but runs for office?
Well, that last one's me, but anti-American, anti-people,
who
I'm anti-state,
me?
You bet.
That's Josh Bennett.
Josh Bennett.
Okay, thank you. My next question is, how do we know that these guys are lying to us when we do go to the boat? Like this last guy who took over and promised to fundamentally transform our country, and that's the only truth he said. The rest of the stuff has all been lies. And he's given the farm away, so of course the folks that are going to vote for him have their hands out. And we're turning our country fundamentally into a socialistic country instead of the free enterprise country that you want and that I want. And we have to get out the vote. And we've got to get the Tea Party people in that have read the Constitution and are willing to take a test on the Constitution.
Judge Roberts read the Constitution, too, and guess what? You got Obamacare.
Yeah, but he didn't read that whole 2,000-word thing. He said that's not his job. His
yep.
job is the people that we put in office, and we do need to kick the bums out, but everybody's got to get out and vote.
And replace them with who?
And replace them with people who really believe that free enterprise is the way to go. People that will undo all these regulations by the Environmental Protection Agency and by the social, you know, the people that want to take over the world.
Well,
that is happening. If we don't get Obama out, we're going to be on a big one world thing, and it's going to be so far worse than you can imagine. And I just, like I said, I don't know. Okay, next thing is we need to all wear T-shirts. I will not comply.
No, I'm with you.
I'm
there.
With you there, 100%.
Let's not comply. Yeah, let's go back to the
and
voting.
And if you
no, want to
buy your
stop,
tickets
stop, stop,
cheaper
stop, stop.
For Glenn Beck the first Friday in September, they're cheaper at Carlson Center than at these other ticket outlets.
Because
you couldn't
we
pay
stop.
Me to go see Glenn Beck.
Stop, back up. We got to get back to the voting part. You want everyone to get out there and get the vote so we can get Obama out. And you're going to replace him with whom? Mitt Romney?
We have, at this point, one
Mitt
choice.
Mitt Romney.
It's,
one choice? Are you?
Yeah,
no,
yeah.
You don't have one choice. There's many more choices. You don't have to vote for either one of the scumbags. Don't tell me that
I'm
a lesser of two
that.
Evil. Mitt
yeah.
Romney is evil. You don't vote for evil. How
Mitt
can you justify
Romney is probably
voting?
That got more integrity in his little finger than this whole town, if you're talking about politicians. That man
if
is
you're talking
generous
about politics.
To a fault.
Wait.
Stop.
How can he be genuine to a fault when his platform changes every 2 weeks?
Mitt Romney
look
was...
Look into his biography.
Are you for abortion?
I am not for abortion.
Mitt Romney
and neither
was.
Is he.
He sure what the heck was until he decided to run for president.
He was
are you for Obamacare?
He found out the truth.
Until he
I
found
think
how?
That man is
are you serious?
Truth.
What? Abortion kills babies? I did not know that.
Yeah, when he's 50
I
years old,
I thought it was just ripping
the,
tissue out of a woman's body.
He's
I
running for the Republican
you,
platform,
you
and now
have,
you're telling me that he is all of a sudden this pro-life guy. No, you got to look at what people are like.
Do you have a better option? Is there at this point in our system some way that you can put somebody else up there?
No, I don't want to put someone else up there. You already said it. Don't give consent.
Donna, let me ask you a question very seriously, all right? If it's a hot day, if someone offers you a nice drink of water, you'd be happy to take it, right?
If it doesn't have fluoride anymore.
Okay, well, what if it had a great big giant cat turd sitting in it?
I would say thanks, but no thanks.
Okay, what you've got between Obama is a great big glass full of cat turd. And with Mitt Romney, you've got a nice drink of cold water with a cat turd sitting in it. Which would you like to have?
I would have neither.
Then thank you very much. That's what we're saying.
But
morally,
need,
you cannot.
We need to get Obama out. If we don't get to
not
the
at
polls,
the cost of Mitt Romney,
he can't possibly stay in another 4 years. he's going to take over the world.
You want,
he thinks King Obama.
No, he is not that powerful. Are you kidding me?
Are you kidding me? They're going to throw him under the bus when they're through with him. In the meanwhile,
who's they?
The Muslim Brotherhood and
who's
all
them?
This.
You need
who's
to quit
them?
Listening
I'm
to Glenn
talking
Beck.
About this whole world business. Listening.
So what about Mitt Romney? You don't think he's a globalist?
Absolutely not. He's only going to have 4 years. And the Tea Partiers are going to take over Congress and the House. And
I thought they already did.
No, they only got into the House. The Republicans are not the Tea Partiers. You just wait and see. But we've got to get behind the constitutionalists.
Yeah,
seriously.
And
we've
you're saying we got to get behind the
constitutionalists
and vote for Mitt Romney. Come on, think about what you're saying. The man
I'm saying
is evil.
He's better than Obama.
He's still evil.
He's
you
a free enterprise man, and he can get us back
on the train. He's a free enterprise man
track.
That benefited from Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. Mm-hmm. How can you say that's free enterprise? Bain Capital?
Listen, if you look into Bain Capital, those guys love him. They saved it for a long time.
I know
it didn't go under
him.
Until 6 years or something after
who's,
he...
Who's the big...
I'm just saying he's doing... We're all humans. We're all living on this planet as imperfect people.
I agree with that.
But he's
so let's quit putting imperfect people in office telling us what we can and can't do. He's imperfect also, so don't vote for him. There is no perfect person. Why do you want someone in there telling you what you can and cannot do?
I think he's going to lift a lot of those regulations because
how on earth could he lift any of those regulations?
Goldman
the same
Sachs.
Way Obama put a lot of them in.
Obama did not. He did not invent the EPA. He did not invent the... Department of Transportation, he didn't invent any of those things. Republicans did, actually.
Or the TSA.
And he didn't invent the TSA. He didn't pass the Patriot Act.
That was a Republican.
He didn't pass
you know,
the
all those original foundations that now support the George Soros stuff started out with the right ideas.
Whoa.
And it was their boards that changed it ultimately. And some of them resigned from their boards, including Henry Ford.
Donna, you just revealed yourself as a progressive.
I am not a progressive.
You just said that these things started out with the right ideas.
No, I'm saying the foundations that support things in this day and time, are very, very socialistic.
Do you know Goldman
started
Sachs?
Started out as philanthropic organizations. Building hotels.
Uh-huh.
I don't mean hotels. Hospitals and the like.
Do you know who Goldman Sachs is?
Yes.
Do you know that they're giving money to Obama and Mitt Romney?
They're giving money
to both?
I know they're
giving money to Planned Parenthood, and they're giving money to anybody that'll get on board with them. And it's disgusting. That's why we have to get out and vote.
No, that's why we have to get out and quit voting. Ignore them. Let
if
them
you
fall
ignore
and
them
fail.
And you don't vote, what will be the consequence
if all
for
of
our
us
country?
Did, then they would be... Well, how many people voted in the last election and look at the consequences of our country? How many people voted before that? How many people voted for George Bush and look at the consequences of our country?
I'm telling people they need to educate themselves and they need to vote for the free enterprise people.
They need
to educate themselves
and come out of the system and quit participating. Just like you said, your third point was to get a shirt that says, I will not comply. Dead on. Do not comply.
But we have to vote.
Why?
We gotta vote the bums out,
and put more bums in.
No, they're not going to be as bad because
as bad.
We're
as
holding
bad.
Their feet. That's
you can
right.
Die.
And then in four more years,
you
we can
die.
Put
Donna,
somebody
Donna,
on there.
If, let me ask you another question, please. This is Steve. If you had a choice on the ballot between Hitler and Stalin, who would you vote for? Who was worse?
Stalin was the worst, but they were both crummy.
So you
would vote for
Hitler? No, that's not the question. The question
is, I want to know how they would have gotten on the ballot
because they had enough people from each of their parties to get them onto the ballot. That's how they got in the ballot in the first place.
Hitler was voted in,
and Stalin was voted in by the Politburo. The point of the matter is, Stalin was wildly popular in his own country at the time.
You can die. Okay, you said
well,
not
I don't
as
think
bad.
That Romney has anything in him that's going to kill one person.
Oh, you're dead wrong there.
I
Mitt
don't
Romney's
going
to
so.
Go to war. Mitt Romney wants to kill lots of brown people.
We've already got Syria on the docket. Iran is ready to be invaded.
But they're not humans because they're not Americans.
Have you heard Romney say he's going to go to war?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he will do anything necessary to stop Iran, supposedly. So that means war.
Well, because we have to protect Israel.
Well, you just said that he's not going to kill anyone. Well, those are people.
Donna, do you fundamentally?
I'm not as well educated apparently as some of you. I just have to disagree. We got to educate the people. We got to get out.
I agree with that.
We got to vote for Tea Party.
I don't agree with that.
And get the socialists out.
And put the fascist in. Let me tell you.
I'm going to change the station now because I don't even like what I'm hearing now.
That's fine.
All right. Thank you for calling in. Please do not listen to something that challenges your thinking.
It definitely. Goes to prove one of me and Josh's biggest points is that we lend legitimacy to being enslaved because we have our option of voting.
Yeah, the whole thing is, I mean, we will not let go of, well, the reason, like we said earlier, the reason we haven't revolted and put an end to this tyranny is because we can vote the bums out and put more bums in. And she said that, you know, we can't necessarily... They're not going to be as bad. Well, guess what? You can get killed by a 45 to the head or a 22 to the head. They may not have as big of a gun, but it still blows your brains out.
No, 22 is not nearly as messy. It'll get in there and rattle around inside your skull.
She took it a step farther than that. She said we can vote out the lesser two evils now, and then in four more years, we can get in the people that we want. And that's all we ever hear.
That's all we've ever heard all my life. That's all I've ever heard. And, I mean, we're supposed to... The fact that people want to run for office in the first place should make us suspicious of them. They want the gun. I agree with Donna in one aspect. She said we should all be wearing shirts that says I will not comply.
But
good
on you. You have to take it a step farther, though, and actually not comply.
Right. Well, it would be a because start to even wear the shirt because that gets people thinking, but I will not comply, but I will vote people to force me to comply.
A couple of weeks ago when we were talking with that guy in Canada, I can't remember his name off the top of my head, one of the anarchists that we've had on.
Jeff?
The farmer doesn't mind if you've got branded on the side of your hide, down with the farmer, as long as you stay inside the corral.
Right.
He doesn't care. But it's once you get outside the corral, then he minds.
You know, I feel Donna's pain. I feel her pain because I'm not making fun of her. I understand what she's saying. She is rightfully concerned about President Obama, and he is a socialist. He's a communist. He's a world government person. He is a globalist. He is a scumbag. But don't replace them with another one. I mean, all we're doing, and the only reason that everyone's defending Romney now is because he's the only choice we have. So they're going to say whatever they can, lying to themselves that he wasn't pro-choice. Well, he was pro-choice till he found out the truth. That's a lie. He said, I will always uphold the woman's right to choose an abortion. So I think he's lying now. He's lying to us about being pro-life. Why do I want to? I mean, the only reason you'd give him that pass is because you just absolutely want it to happen.
Donna sounded so much like my own mother. God bless her soul. She's a wonderful woman, and she sounds exactly like Donna when it comes to this idea of drinking the Kool-Aid about, well, we have to vote. And my mom is so disappointed in me that I'm honestly considering not voting in this election. She's like... But what's going to happen? You have to vote. Let me the question about Mitt Romney and would he go to war? Let me read you word for word. When questioned, here was the question asked him: how do you prevent Iran from obtaining a nuclear weapon? Is it worth going to war to prevent that? Romney answers: well, it's worth putting in place crippling sanctions. It's worth working with the insurgents in the company to encourage regime change in the country. And if all else fails, if after all the work we've done, there's nothing else we can do besides take military action, then of course you take military action. It is unacceptable for Iran to have a nuclear weapon. We will not allow Iran to have a nuclear weapon.
But it is acceptable to kill little brown kids and carpet bomb and do whatever you must do to kill the terrorists.
He didn't actually say that, but that's the implication of what...
No, that's exactly what that means. Mm-hmm.
So, well, and that, what, you know, what, why is it acceptable for us to have a nuclear weapon?
Well,
and nobody else?
Because then we get to be the bullies. And we're the only ones that have ever used one. I should ask Donna, who, and I'm glad she's listening to the show. I wish, hopefully she'll call back again sometime. I should have asked her if she was a Christian. And if she was, how could she morally put her name down as voting for, as she even admitted, the lesser of two evils? How, as a religious person, can you vote for evil? Evil,
because
no matter what.
Because he's going to protect Israel.
He's
going to
protect
Israel.
Okay. But seriously, this is a serious question.
I am being
How serious. Do you, as a religious person, vote for someone just because you say they're the lesser of two evils? We've been doing that for a long time. I've heard a lot of Christians say, well, yeah, you know, we're stuck with this choice. We only have one choice. He's the lesser of two evils. How dare you call yourself a religious person and vote for evil? How can you do that? How can you justify a vote for evil? You cannot. So your only choice as a religious person that actually says and shall believe in God, if you really believe in God, call yourself a Christian, a Mormon, Catholic, whatever you want to say, you may not vote in this election and keep your faith and keep from being a hypocrite in your faith. You cannot vote because there is no choice but evil. So if you're going to vote this election, then you're basically turning your back on God and saying, God, I know I say that I'm a Christian and whatnot, and I can say that you're in charge of everything, but you just don't got it quite right here, so I'm going to have to vote for Mitt Romney, even though he's the lesser of two evils. So you're going to either put your faith where your mouth is and don't vote and say and live your life saying that you believe in God. If you believe in God, don't vote. If you really believe that he controls the future, don't vote. If you really think that he does not, then vote for Mitt Romney and vote for evil. Have at it.
Wow. All right, those who got on hold, stay with us. Real quick, the website for Patriots, we're coming up on Patriots Lament, but the Saturday morning wake-up call kind of rolls into it. PatriotsLament.blogspot.com.
Yes.
And the email address is PatriotsLament@gmail.com. Sorry. And we'll be right back in the next hour with Patriots Lament. All right, welcome to Patriots Lament right here on KFAR, where for the next hour we're going to be talking about the principles behind liberty and what that actually means. I'm Steve Floyd, the man with the pacemaker radio, the monkey behind the machine. Joining me in the studio, the sponsors of the program, Aaron Bennett from Far North Tactical and Josh Bennett from Bighorn Enterprises. Also in the studio, but not saying a whole lot today, is one of their other brothers, Nate. Morning, Nate.
Morning. For the record, he's the ugliest brother.
No, that's coming from you. That's amazing to hear. Because, all right.
Wow.
We've had at the top of the hour, we always do going from wake up call into Patriots Lament as we clear the lines to make sure that there's no holdovers, and so we have actually all of our lines back on hold with people who have called in.
Because it's a totally different
since
show.
The news began here at the beginning of the hour. I suspect that there's likely to be a little spillover in terms of what we had been talking about last hour. For those just joining, obviously the fallout from Obamacare being upheld as constitutional this week, one of the biggest issues is that the Republicans are using this as the clarion call to get out the vote. And I'm hearing an awful lot of people who would not normally be marching with the Republicans pounding that same drum of get out the vote, get out the vote. And you, Josh, one of the things that you've come under fire for is you're saying, don't go out and vote.
Don't go out and vote.
And
don't lend legitimacy to
there you go.
What's going on. That's all you're doing.
Well, and it comes down to if our only choice is the choice between evil and evil, then why go out and choose evil at all? If you would not go out and it's like that illustration I give of the glass of cold icy water with a nice great big cat turd on it.
Right.
Why would you choose that? If somebody gives you have a choice of this evil or that evil, you have been given a false choice, and the best thing you can possibly do is what Donna admitted, thanks but no thanks. I will not have either of those choices.
Right. Were you going to say something, Nate?
I was going to say, maybe the glass with the lesser turd in it might taste less worse. So we'll just try that.
I mean, it's, you use the same metaphor with Stalin and Hitler. Which one are you going to vote for? I mean, Stalin was worse. That didn't make Hitler good. It definitely didn't make him good enough to vote for.
Well, it's just sad just because the only reason people are defending Romney and saying he's our answer to the problems is because they think he's the only choice. I mean, Donna said it. We don't have a choice. We only have one option. That's not true. If you want to vote, you can write in someone.
No, we have another option, Josh. In 4 years, we get to put our guy in.
Right. Down the road. Always kicking the can down the road for your children to pay for it, the grandchildren to pay for it, their grandchildren to pay for it, on and on and on. You do have more than one option. We've been brainwashed. Ultimately, totally brainwashed to think that our only choice is to vote the bums out and put more bums in. It's a false choice. It's not even a real choice. It's totally false. And until we decide that we want to have a real choice, one that will actually make change, and refuse to consent, like Donna said, that will make change. Positive change. I positively guarantee that will make change. But as long as we want to just keep voting in the smaller gun, the bigger gun, the lesser evil, the bigger evil, have at it. I'm just sick and tired of you people pointing guns at me. And that's really what it comes down to. I'm tired of people voting to point guns at me. Mm-hmm. How dare you guys do that? I mean, when you call in and say, I'm going to vote for someone, might as well just come shoot me in the head. Because that's all you're saying. I'm going to vote for someone to point a gun at you. Well,
take it down to the lowest possible level. If you, in a neighborhood, say you lived in a cul-de-sac, a theoretical cul-de-sac, and you found out that the rest of your neighbors got together and decided to vote you out of the neighborhood, how would you feel about that?
Not too good, especially when they came over with the, especially if they had the right to use force. Yeah.
Well, do you feel it would be right for you to join in with your other neighbors and vote to get rid of
them?
Somebody else down the street?
No.
Do you think that you have the right to go over to your neighbor's house and take away his guns because you don't like him?
No.
It's unacceptable that Joe down the street would have a rifle. It's unacceptable that he should arm himself. I am going to go and take away, first I'm going to put sanctions on him. I'm going to make sure that he doesn't get his newspaper delivered. I'm going to make sure that his I'm going to put all of the sanctions I possibly can on Joe down the street because it is absolutely unacceptable that he should arm himself. So what I'm going to do is if those sanctions fail, if he still gets all of his deliveries, if the pizza man still makes it to his house, if he still gets his newspaper, and even if he doesn't, if that doesn't force him to give up his gun, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to move in with some more. I'm going to help his children to rebel against him. If that doesn't work to get rid of his guns, then I'm going to go kick his door down and take his gun and take his gun away.
Wait a minute. Kill him. I have a question, though. Is this neighbor, that hypothetical neighbor we're talking about, what ethnicity is he?
Oh, well, he's a Muslim.
Oh, no. He should have said that at the very beginning.
We could have skipped all the sanctions and just killed him.
But isn't that exactly what's going on with Iran right now?
Yep. Absolutely.
You guys ready to go to the phones?
Yep.
458-TALK is the number.
Absolutely.
Good morning, caller. Who's this?
This is Randy.
Good morning, Randy.
Well, good morning. I really appreciate you letting Donna on for as long as you did. That was a good, interesting discussion, and I hope that Donna takes Josh's invitation and calls in again. I think two people should never be afraid of talking something out and having a debate. You know, nobody loses in a debate. Both people end up with more insight, and it's a shame to cut people off or something like that, right in the mid-thought. But anyway, what I was calling about is last week you were having a very good discussion about Schaefer Cox, and I called in and gave my two cents. But after I was off the air, off the line, Aaron gave some opinions about some things that I feel, and I thought I'd do a little clarifying here, if I may. Aaron, you were saying that I want to force kids to pledge allegiance to the state.
You said that if you had it your way, you would make it mandatory that all children pledge allegiance to a flag of some sort or to the state flag, the Alaska state flag, say the Pledge of Allegiance. I did hear that right.
Yeah. Well, I'll just clarify what I believe. I believe that the schools should have the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands. You know, the words of the pledge. I am very much against any kind of pledge to the state. And to me, to some people, it may seem like, oh, what's the difference between Republic, state, you know. But to me, there's a big distinction. To me, the word state means the government that's in place right now, you know, the people in there, the laws, whatever, and I would be against pledging allegiance to the state, but I am in favor.
What do you think pledging allegiance to a republic is?
Pledging allegiance to a republic, if you look up in the dictionary what republic means, that means where the power is vested in the people and they have a representative government.
Are you a Christian, Randy?
Well, I try to be.
Then you can't pledge anything.
Well, I believe...
Randy, no O-O-O's. Are you a Christian, Randy?
I try to be.
Then you cannot and may not, as a Christian, pledge allegiance to a flag. You may not give your pledge.
Well, maybe I'm not a good Christian because I do believe in pledging allegiance to the flag.
So just forget what God says. Yeah, just chuck the Bible. That's fine.
Yeah. Well, anyway, I just wanted to clarify that I am against pledging allegiance to the state, and also...
And you're also against following the Bible. That's great. Okay.
All right, and Josh is giving the cutoff call, so Josh has pulled the plug on Randy. I just want to make sure that it's clear, Randy, that it is...
I'll make it clear, Randy. Josh, I pulled the plug on you. I'm
not
going to sit here and
Steve.
Listen to it forever and ever and ever. You want to pledge allegiance, go ahead. And then you said you're a Christian.
But don't make us pledge allegiance to your state.
Right.
458 Talk is the number. Good morning, caller.
Good morning.
Hey, who is this?
This is Rick.
Rick, go ahead.
Hey, Rick. How you doing?
Hey, Josh, how's it going? Wow. Boy, doesn't it just illustrate the problem that we have to deal with here? I mean, it's depressing.
I know. I pulled the left side of my hair is gone because I ripped it out just a little bit ago.
You know, what it boils down to is all these people feel they have the right to force their way of thinking on you.
Yep.
That's what it boils down to. And they're going to get their guy in to point his gun at you this time. You know, whether it's Romney, Obama, you know, whoever it may be, they're going to point a gun at you and make you do what they want. And, you know...
I think it's ironic that they use the Constitution and the founding and all this and that stuff to justify that, too, because I'm pretty sure the revolution was not... I mean, as far as the farmers fighting in the fields, as far as Thomas Jefferson and Patrick Henry, I'm almost positive that had nothing to do with forcing you to do what someone else wants you to do. I think it was the exact opposite. But they invoke those people... They invoke the revolution, they invoke those things and say, and at the same time say, and I want to put my gun in against your head.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't understand that.
Well, you know, and it's do you believe in the non-aggression principle or not, you know? And a lot of these people, I think they don't even know what that is, you know? So, you know, what I'm hearing, you know, what I heard from that Donna and stuff is typically what I thought we heard down at the Republican convention.
Yep.
You know, and it's, you know... But my question, the reason I was calling in is because I wanted to know, you know, just listening to this, you know, we know that's not going to happen, that people are not going to go out and not vote. You're not going to get because you need a majority of people to go out there to be disenfranchised from the whole system in order to make that work.
Well, hang on a second, Rick. I mean, before we go any farther.
Sure.
You know what happened in Ketchikan this week?
I heard you say that earlier.
On Tuesday, they had a vote about bonding for harbor improvements. A grand total of 237 people showed up, which for the city of Ketchikan is approximately 7% of the registered voters. I mean, there's a whole bunch of people that are not registered to vote as well.
Sure.
But only 7% of the registered voters showed up and passed the bonding, which means now everybody in Ketchikan is going to pay more for those harbor improvements.
That's right. And
so
how many of those
93% of the people did not show up and vote. That, I think, is a pretty clear majority. How does not voting work?
We see that in our own borough here, you know, when we vote on bond issues and stuff. Only a few people come out, you know, a very small minority come out and vote. You know, and so they always pass these bond issues, even though, well, at any rate, the point is then what is going to happen from there? And that's what I was going to ask Josh and Aaron and, you know, you guys, what happens, say, if we do come out and not vote? What, I mean, what it comes down to is we're going to have to stand there and be willing to be shot in the head, because that's ultimately what it's going to come down to. They're going to come shoot you in the head if you don't pay.
Right. The way our system works, even a guy that wants to just live his own life and go out and make a living and be productive has to get involved in politics, has to viciously get involved in them.
Which corrupts you right there.
Exactly. It's a hard choice. I mean, basically, if you're going to live with NAP, non-aggression principle, then you have to follow it all the way. You have to, if you're not going to vote, then, I mean, the greatest thing that would happen in Ketchikan is the people that didn't vote for the bond refused to pay it. The other 93%.
Right.
That would be revolutionary.
Absolutely, it would. But,
when the guns came out, I don't know. I guess then if you have 93%, what do? You tell the state, all right, you're going to kill every one of these people?
Well, you're going to go to jail probably, you know,
and
non-aggression.
Are you going to throw all those people in jail? Well, non-aggression principle stops at self-defense.
Yeah.
See, and now then think about it here, too. I mean, I don't know what the powers of Ketchikan have, if they actually have police powers in Ketchikan. I don't know in terms of what would happen if somebody didn't pay their taxes. But here in the Fairbanks North Star Borough,
mm-hmm.
our borough does not have police powers. Our
right.
borough does not have the power to enact a single one or enforce a single one of their ordinances. And yet people bow down and lick the hand every single time the borough sneezes. For instance, what happened just this week with the issue of the road powers and the expansion and the denial and all of that, about people trying to go out and subdivide their land.
Right.
Bottom line is this. If you decided, you know what, forget the borough, I'm going to just go ahead and subdivide my land. The only thing they could do would be to try to pursue you in court. And
right.
the track record is that they will not.
And they lose.
And they lose when they try.
Yeah, they lose.
Therefore, I encourage everyone, you know what? Subdivide your lot. Subdivide it and see what happens. They're going to try to take you to court? No, especially if hundreds or thousands of people did not comply.
There is a principle that we've talked about. I know I've talked about this personally with you, Rick,
mm-hmm.
of voting in self-defense.
Yeah.
I mean, as far as
kind of
a bond
we were doing
like
with
that.
Ron Paul.
Right. As far as a bond, maybe you should go vote in self-defense. I personally don't want to be a part of that system at all. But I definitely don't think there's anything self-defense-wise or whatever in a national political vote, in a presidential vote, in a borough assembly vote. I mean, that's, you're voting for someone, which person, to point the gun and kill. That's all there is to it. And I guess we just have to be moralist in our own minds, I guess, and say whether we're going to get shot or not, we're not going to participate. And you know what? The Quakers did that in 1600s, and guess what? It worked.
Yeah.
It took a while. A lot of them got beat, killed, marred, drug around behind a cart naked and trashed on and quartered and all that, but eventually they found their own independence.
I've heard that a lot of them are moving at this point to
yes.
South America.
Mennonites and Quakers are leaving en masse right
yeah.
now, and that might be a cue for the rest of us because
mm-hmm.
they left en masse from
England. England, exactly.
I've sent for my Spanish lessons, so.
Right on.
Ready to go, you know, after, you know, David leaving and everything, so.
Yep. Yeah, I was trying to get him to call.
Hey, thanks for the call.
All right.
We have a guest line here. Shall
okay.
we try that
yeah.
and see who it is? Good morning, caller.
Speak of the devil.
Nice. And the devil appears. Are you calling from a undisclosed location, Dave?
No, I'm calling from Socialist Canada.
Nice.
Wonderful.
We
is
can
it?
Disclose that.
Very, very different from non-socialist America.
Dave Giesel, of course, calling in here, one of our anarcho-capitalist friends.
So one of the differences, I'm just going to throw out a difference, and then I'm going to talk about the last caller. So in the Waterloo area, which is where Research in Motion is, a BlackBerry company, who used to be successful, it's one of the highest property tax areas in the region because it's a very wealthy area. And so I found out that the property tax on a house that's twice as valuable as my house in the borough is half as much. So the property tax per dollar in socialist Canada in a very wealthy city is one quarter that of Donna Gilbert's tax capped Fairbanks North Star Borough.
Nice.
Just thought I would throw that one out.
I'm glad you did. That makes me feel really good, David.
So anyway, as far as not voting, there's a couple other angles on that. One of them is self-respect, mm-hmm. right? If you respect yourself, you're not going to vote for a slave master. And of course, the other angle is a belief in fantasy. Like, how many of us sit around the Christmas tree waiting for Santa Claus to show up at midnight?
Me.
Okay, I mean, a couple of us do, but,
bad example, Dave.
You know, most of us as adults don't do that. Or if, like, we knock a tooth out, we don't put it under our pillow and wait for the tooth fairy to bring us money. So why on earth?
Aaron, again, really?
Okay. Why on earth would we vote? Why would we vote?
Because this time it's going to work.
Well, yeah, we know it's not going to.
Well,
right?
It's not going to this time, Dave, but 4 years from now.
And even if, especially us who have, done some reading, which, anybody who's read the blog has read something about this, we know it's not going to work. So why do we still believe in it, right? Why are we still waiting for Santa Claus to come down the chimney? I mean, it's more of a personal thing of just taking back your time and your energy. Because if you're going to go out and vote, you're going to invest a certain amount of your emotions and your energy, the time you have to make the world a better place, into this fantasy. And so why not scrape that time back and do something useful with it? I mean, that would be the reason that I don't vote.
I think the underlying question, David, is people say, well, what do we do then?
Anything else.
Let the chips fall where they may.
go for a walk outside in your neighborhood or something, or get another hour of sleep or something.
Or go on a radio show every Saturday. I don't know.
Or go on a radio show. I mean, but any of those activities are going to be of significantly more tangible personal benefit to you than pissing time and energy away, not only voting, but trying to convince other people to vote for the same guy and looking at election results and all of this and stressing out over it, right? Oh, no, he lost. The Supreme Court ruled in the favor of the government. I'm stunned and shocked and disappointed. I mean, it's insane. It's lunacy. It's a belief in fairy tales. And so if you know better, scrape that time back. Take your own life back.
And actually, I think the ruling was pretty good.
Yeah, right in line with the Constitution.
Yep.
We can do whatever we want from day one. That's what it says.
Yep. From day one.
Dave, you want to stay on the line while we take other callers?
I'm gonna bounce. I got to get back to my socialist utopia.
Right. Thanks for calling, man.
Thanks for calling our socialist utopia at the same time. 458 Talk is the number. Good morning, caller. You're on Patriots Lament. Who's this?
Good morning. This is Lee.
Lee, go ahead.
Well, I don't know what criteria you use for clearing out the phones during the first hour break, but I was one of those that was on the line then.
No problem.
The criteria is that it turned to from 9 to 10 o'clock. That's the only criteria. We just, as a matter of principle, we clear all the lines so that there's absolutely clear that there is a break.
Oh,
that's it.
Nice to know that. All right. Well, anyway, in this advocacy of, apparently, Steve, you're sharing in this do not vote advocacy?
I don't know. This is what I'm saying, Mr. Despain, is that I'm finding myself torn. Because I have been so programmed my entire life to believe that we have a responsibility, we have a duty, it's the highest privilege of man that we can go out and vote. And since I turned 18, I have voted in every election I could. Not just the national ones. I've voted on every local election. I've voted for every bond. I'm not for it, but actually against every bond. But in every bond election, I have voted for everything from city council to borough assembly to dog catcher, everything I possibly can, everywhere I've been around the world, I have participated in the system, and I have been continually disappointed over and over and over again. And now I've got these people basically pointing out to me that if I choose the lesser of two evils, I am still choosing evil, and that makes sense.
Well, if that makes sense to you, Steve, just think about where we would be if good people hadn't voted for, let's just say, the last 50 or 200 years. And
can't say 200 because they weren't voting 200 years ago.
You wouldn't allow... Oh, I lost my train of thought there. But the triumph of evil will certainly prevail in our democratic and or republic type society, and you stop voting and guarantee. My question is, with this advocacy of just don't vote, realistically, now you guys are hypotheticalizing in a very...
Hang on one sec. Actually, we're going historically, not hypothetically. Historically,
listen to me just a second. You specifically are advocating don't vote. Now, realistically, and there's a, that leaves a lot of wiggle room, but realistically, in this election, you're advocating don't vote in this presidential upcoming election. And for all these reasons you're giving for not voting, one is if you're a Christian, which, well, what a stretch, but nevertheless.
How's that a stretch? How is that a stretch?
Hang on. Everybody, can we take a pause? I will come right back to this line. We are not going anywhere except for the fact that we have to take a break here for the Fox News at the bottom of the hour, or else the entire fabric of the world will unravel. Stay with us on KFAR. This is Local Talk Radio. That's Pantera right there. Revolution is my name. Welcome back to Patriot's Lament right here on KFAR. I'm Steve Floyd, the one basically just pushing the buttons to make sure that we stay on the air. Joining us on the phone is it Lee?
Yeah.
All right. And, of course, still here in the studio with us, we've got from Bighorn Enterprises, Josh Bennett, and from Foreign Earth Tactical, Aaron Bennett, and from Parts Unknown, we've got Nate over there as well, Mr. Bennett, welcome to the program. All right.
Go ahead and finish with your thought, Lee.
Okay, my question is, given your advocacy, realistically, what percentage of the voters do you think you can affect with this advocacy of yours this morning in the next presidential election, let's just say in the country?
Probably not that many this go around, but it doesn't mean you stop. I mean, it's the right thing.
Okay.
So,
a few percent. Is that a realistic, a few percentage of the non-vote people?
I think it's going to be probably 20 to 25, maybe 30% this time.
I think you're hallucinating.
I don't think so.
That's okay.
I heard
fine.
The Ron Paul revolution.
That's fine. But you think they're not going to vote?
I think quite a few of them are not going to vote.
Okay. Well, in the event that they don't vote, who do you think will win the next presidential election? Guaranteed.
Probably Obama.
Okay, given. That's a given.
And he's now, only got 4 more years, and he's out.
Oh, yeah. Only 4 more years. Thank you very much. I'm glad you're looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to that, too, but it's what he can do in that next 4 years compared to what he did in the last 4 years that scares the living crap out of me.
Well, if you got a Congress defeating him, right?
You're not going to vote for Congress. So
we already have a Republican Congress, so what's there to worry about?
You're going to let other people vote for Congress. And now you brought the subject up. Who do you think is going to carry the Congress if your message, I think, is primarily being heard by, I'm not talking just the radio station today, but this non-vote movement, is being heard primarily by conservative type thinking people as opposed to liberal type thinking people. Is that a fair assessment?
I'd like to go back a little bit and address what you first said. You said, what would America look like right now if good people hadn't got out there and voted, right? But what are we voting for, essentially? I mean, the core of what we're voting for is to put people in power to legislate law. And so anytime that there's any law being passed of any kind, it's stripping away freedom. So, actually, if we wanted to protect liberties, we wouldn't have voted for anybody.
Well,
because
any
time you give a legislative body the power not only to tax, but to legislate what law is, how can there be any liberty under that kind of system?
Well, now, see, there you are just, you're hallucinating because you can't. Okay.
How is that hallucinating? Have you ever read
history? Because in the real world,
200 years later, things have gotten progressively worse to the point where you're paying 40% of your income in taxes, and there's so many paper laws on the books you can't even tell what law is. So how am I hallucinating?
50 years ago, people had just stopped voting. The people that you're preaching to, if you think the people that have an ulterior motive to suck on the public tit and siphon money right out of the taxpayers' pocket into theirs. If you think those people are going to go away and stop voting, you're smoking something that really probably isn't real legal.
You're only using part of our argument. We're saying don't vote, don't give consent, and get rid of the government, period.
Yeah, but realistically, that ain't going to happen.
You're saying right now, you don't know that's not going to happen eventually. I mean, did 200 years ago, do you think they thought Obama would be? 200 years ago, do you think that the founding fathers thought there would be a President Obama?
You realize that is, no, I mean, there ain't a chance.
Of course not. So don't say it could never happen because you're looking at right now, and it's not true. I mean, the largest voting bloc right now are non-voters. There are more people that don't vote than people that do. And tell me what your voting has done. What, George Bush?
I'll go back before
that. Tell us that George Bush and all his wisdom and everything that gave us the Patriot Act? The conservatives that give us war and Patriot Acts and National Defense Authorization Acts?
Even Reagan, who everybody holds up, Reagan, this great bastion of conservative thought, he gave us the Education Department.
And one of the hugest deficits
ever
of all
Nixon.
Eisenhower.
Nixon gave us the EPA.
Look at the wars that Eisenhower gave us with Korea and with...
Will you show me where your voting has given us more liberty, and then we'll rethink our position You show me where voting has given you more liberty.
If you would shut up and let somebody talk, I would try to...
I let you talk for a long time and held you over the break. I pay for the show.
Is it my turn?
Go for it.
If you think non-voting is the way to improve our lot, I'm
no, that's fine.
Shocked.
You don't have to agree, but you show me where voting has improved our lot.
Well, again, this country has escalated so far above any other country on the planet using the voting principle that you are so advocating against.
How do you figure? How? Where have we advanced because of voting? The Industrial Revolution was from voting?
I'm just saying,
The Industrial Revolution was from the opening up of the free market, from the government being restricted into the market. It didn't start to get stagnated and slow down until government regulation suppressed it to the point we're at now.
Well, you folks are going to outlive me for sure, but I just hope you don't achieve what you're striving for. Because
liberty?
You are going to get...
Liberty?
Yeah, I'm way older than you guys.
No, I'm saying what we strive for is liberty and not having someone vote to point a gun at our heads.
Well, but when you got...
And go back...
You're using hypothetical arguments because...
We're using history. The Anabaptists...
We have evil in this real world, and those folks are going to vote whether you want them to vote or not.
And you're going to vote for evil, too.
Yeah, but my evil will be less than their evil. That's the whole
I mock that whole supposition because it's bull. You're going to vote for lesser of two evils. How can you justify that?
Because
you're going to go and tell God that God, at least I voted for the lesser of two evil.
You're damn right.
All right.
There you go. Okay.
God gave me a brain, and I'm supposed to use it. And somewhere in your Bible, maybe you can find that and stop lambasting people and telling them they can't vote if they're Christians. Because I'm sorry, that is going to be that.
You show me in the Bible where God advocates evil. Show me in the Bible where God advocates evil.
Show me in the Bible where God advocates voting.
I'm not a scholar of the Bible like you are, but you don't vote.
I just asked.
If this country takes up the do not vote bandwagon, those people that are voting on this liberal agenda that's got us in such a financial bind right now that we can't even speak intelligently about it. But trust me, they will prevail, and you will be able to see this in your lifetime. Probably, hopefully, not in my lifetime.
Isn't the fact that
this country will go into because of those that decry you good people that don't want to vote because for some crazy reason. Don't use your brain that God gave you to pick out, but if you're educating yourself on the matter, don't vote. That's the demise of this country, and I'm just trying to speculate. Thank you very much for the show.
Thank you for the call.
We can actually prove the demise of this country from voting. Voting has been the demise of this country because people vote to steal. That's what voting is, to put your guy in to steal. And don't say that because Obama's in there now that we're going to have, because of Obama, we have more debt. How much debt did we get from Reagan? How much debt did we get from Bush?
No.
And how can you say that you're going to stand in front of God and say, you're darn right, God, I voted for evil?
Well, that's the whole thing is that it's all based on comparison. If you have gone out and you've killed five people, do you think you can stand before God and say, well, God, I only killed five. Look at that guy over there. He killed 20.
Unless you're government, then you can kill him in the millions and it's okay.
Like Dave just wrote a text and he said that none of them will prevail over him. And he doesn't vote.
Well, he's also left the country.
Aha.
He has completely opted out.
I just don't understand how you can give people the power to tax you and to legislate what law is and expect them to not be corrupt.
And to vote for the corruption. People, the Anabaptists for 1,000 years have preached noncompliance and not voting and all that kind of stuff. So it's not like historical context. It's not like this is brand new.
And look at how many people they've killed by doing that.
None.
What?
None.
How many people have they put in cages because they refused to participate in the system?
I really like...
Thousand?
I just love the fact that people admit that they're going to vote for the lesser of two evil. They admit that it's evil, and they're going to do it anyway. So if it's evil, how is it right? How can it be right if it's evil? You admit that it's evil, but it's less evil than the other one. I mean,
well,
compared
to
who? Who judges that point?
We had a caller like 2 weeks ago who said that taxes are stealing, but we have to have some taxes.
Well, a little bit of stealing is okay.
As long as you don't steal too much.
He couldn't tell us how much was enough.
And I get the point that people hate Obama. That's fine. I don't like the guy either at all. Doesn't mean I want Mitt Romney pointing a gun at me. And you know what? If these people do get their way, like they say, well, if the good people just quit voting, then all these corrupt people are going to get it and blah, blah, blah. Guess what's going to happen anyway?
It's going to lead to an actual revolution.
It'll lead to a collapse.
Exactly.
They will not prevail. They will not prevail. They will collapse on themselves. I just happen to choose not to be a part of their collapse. I choose not to be a part of it. I choose to let it happen as fast as it wants to. Let them have it. Collapse
I think
away.
We should all vote for Obama. That way it collapses under a Democrat instead of under a Republican.
Bum ba da bum bum.
458-TALK is the number. Good morning,
no, that's
caller.
That's a good point right there. Right. I mean, the Republicans should want Obama to stay in, so when it collapses, well, they can blame him and
that's
say
the thing too,
Republicanism
is
the way to go.
Going back to the other hour, which is, of course, a completely different show, one of the things that Donna was saying about we need to get Romney in now, and then the Tea Party will come in and take it 4 years later. If we are headed toward a collapse, a fundamental dissolution basically of our economics and possibly our entire political system, and it happens under Romney, do you think there's any possible way of getting a Tea Party in?
No,
because they have been so inextricably linked with the Republicans. They got in bed with them from day one.
Yep.
458-TALK is the number. Good morning, caller.
Trying to help you guys out.
John Galt,
thanks for calling in. How are things down there in Galt's Gulch?
Well, pretty good, actually. Just a sovereign individual down here, feeding the chickens and cooking the sourdoughs. Anecdotally, I'd like to say that you need to vote, and I'd suggest Ron Paul.
You mean as a write-in, like a protest vote?
Not a protest vote. I'm vote your conscience, but he's the only man that's advocating for constitutional liberties here.
Mr. Galt, I agree with what you're saying. However, you see, back in 2008, in the Senate election here in Alaska, we had Ted Stevens, who was a convicted felon. Even though that conviction was tossed out on a technicality later, it did not change the fact that at the time he was a convicted felon. And you've got Mark Begich, who was a flaming liberal Democrat. And what a lot of people fail to recognize, that you also had a couple of other candidates, including a libertarian. And I went out and I felt my need to vote my conscience in that particular case. I voted for the Libertarian, and I have been excoriated for doing so. I have been blamed for putting baggage in office because I voted my conscience and voted for Mr. Byrd. So, how do you answer that?
Well, Steve, I'd like to say this. I'll preface this with saying I'm a Christian. And I'm one of these Christians that I'm a sinner, I know that. But I delivered all my children at home. All right? I trusted in God so much. My third delivery, the umbilical cord was wrapped around my son's neck. I delivered the head and decided to tie the umbilical cord off and snip the cord. But it was a difficult birth. And we made it through. This gal loved me so much. She loved God so much that she trusted God, perhaps even more than I did. My point is this, that all God-fearing people need to get out there and vote their conscience. And I suggest Ron Paul, 2012. He stood around in medical school and watched an abortion one time. The fetus was thrown in a garbage can. It was still alive. Can you imagine the emotion that must have reigned through that man's head in medical school, sworn to save life and to see that? I love this show. And I love you guys. Take care. God bless.
Thank you very much. Thanks. Appreciate that. 458 Talk is the number. Incidentally, in the chat room, Sam logged on to ask why we cut our callers off if we don't agree with them. Why didn't you at least wait until they finished their thought before ganging up on them? And I simply responded with a question mark, and he said, "You apparently don't listen to yourself," and logged out.
Oh, we gave Donna like 10 minutes, and Lee at least. We even held him over.
Yeah.
I mean, we want to give everyone a fair shot here. I mean,
we even gave Randy a fair shot.
But the principle behind this is, I mean, bottom line is that you guys sponsor the show, and you have an agenda.
Yeah, definitely.
You have a...
It's not so much that we sponsor the show.
You are the show.
I bought the show. Yeah. It's a little bit more than sponsoring. I paid for the show. It's my show.
You paid for every minute. That's why there are no other commercials.
Right, there's no commercials. The second hour, Josh paid for that show. It's his show. I mean, if he wanted to just sit here and have static, that he could do that.
And this radio station would be perfectly good with that because
it's paid for.
You know, and in fact, going back to, in fact, right here in the history of the radio station, one of the things that Perry Wally's dad, Bill Wally, always said was, you know what? I don't care if we have the sound of a shoe banging on the microphone if it's paid for.
Well, we like people to call in that don't like us or disagree with us. I mean, that's way more fun than agreement. I mean, someone calls in and disagrees with us. That's kind of boring. And we appreciate those calls, too. But, I mean, the point is to have discussion. But, I mean, obviously, there comes a time when you just end the call and move on. Because
you realize that you're not getting anywhere. You
know. Right. There's only so much. And then bickering doesn't do them any good. It doesn't do us any good. So let's move on and try again.
Right, and we always take whatever person called and reiterate and go over it and put our point of view across about what was just discussed. It's always going to be that way. The person I just called in isn't sitting here in the studio.
Right. Now, and if you are sitting at home would like to have an hour to talk about your own issues, call me. I would be happy to sell you some airtime. 458 Talk is the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
Mr. Winston.
Winston, good morning. What's on your mind?
The whole voting issue. Who's the most evil, Mickey Mouse or Donald Duck?
Donald Duck, by far.
That's what I thought. Yeah. He
loses his temper.
I believe in voting in self-defense. And if there's an office there and either one of the two people are, you know, if I consider them to be evil, then I just write in Mickey Mouse or Minnie Mouse or, I mean, I'm going to vote for Ron Paul. I mean, it's what would one of these politicians do if they lost to Mickey Mouse?
Well, if you wrote in Mickey Mouse, they might put Obama back in.
Well, that's
he
true.
Does have the ears.
Yeah.
You know, it's a really good. I don't have a problem with people do what you want to do if you want to vote or whatever. I just have a different opinion with that, and I have no problem with people voting in self-defense. I can see.
I really admire that point of view. That's a good.
I can see that the legitimacy for that. And what boggles my mind is people get so mad, flaming mad at us for saying we're not going to vote.
Well, that they call you anti-American.
Yeah, anti-people, anti-liberty.
Anti-state of Alaska, yeah.
Wait a minute. When Lisa Murkowski's write-in campaign went on, they decided that all the misspelled Murkowskis would go to her, right?
Mm-hmm. They did.
So Nate's right. If you put in Mickey Mouse, that might be a vote for Obama.
Well, it is. I mean, but the way I look at it is if Obama's in for another 4 years, the whole system's going to collapse. If Romney goes in, the system might last 6 years. We're doomed to collapse anyway.
Yep.
It's like the people in Ketchikan. 200 and something people turn out for a bond. I'm going to vote against anybody trying to take money away from me.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just basic self-defense.
Yeah.
And then whenever they come around and want to collect tax from them because there's more idiots went in and voted for it than against it, then I'm going to tell them, say no.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm going to participate as long as I can, and when I can no longer participate, then I'm going to tell them no. I'm not doing it. I'm not complying. It's out of the question.
And moving consent.
What are they going to do? Lock me up? Feed me 3 times a day? Let me watch television?
Give you access to
a
gym? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Access to a gym.
Maybe finally have some time to get that reading done. I've been playing.
Talk to you later.
Thanks for the call, Winston. 458 Talk is the number. This is Patriots Lament. Who's on our phone?
Yeah, good morning. Frank Turner here.
Hey, Frank. Thank you for helping to sponsor this program.
Yeah, Frank, thank you.
I'm waiting for Jesse Ventura's new book. It's about the gangs, the Republican and Democrats. It's the Crips and the Bloods. It's called Democrats and Republicans. Do you remember that old bumper sticker around? Don't blame me. I voted for Joe Vogler. Well, don't blame me. I'm voting for Ron Paul. And one other thing. Happy birthday, Steve. Yeah. Happy birthday, Steve Floyd. Wow, July 3rd, the day before the July Declaration of Independence.
I was actually told that when I was born, I was red with a little fuse coming out of my head.
Hey, firecracker. Keep it up.
Thanks for the call, Frank. 458 Talk is the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
Hi, this is Vivian. Wanted to call and remind everybody we have the home heating petition at the Ranch Motel right there. Donna's got one, so you can go in and sign it to protect our right to burn solid fuels to heat our homes without penalties.
That's a self-defense measure, isn't it?
Absolutely. And as you all know, education has worked in the borough, and the borough had to admit air quality got better. So, you know, instead of fining us, taking us our money, we need to be able to heat our homes for a reasonable price. So we're in a hard push, guys. We've got 1,000 more signatures. We got to get them in July 15th. To be clear, we need it on the ballot. That is why the deadline is so close. It's because the deadline we use to get things on the ballot, and it has to be on the ballot. So please encourage everyone to pick up the petition. I know everyone has friends. I don't care if you have 10 friends, 20 friends, 50 friends, or if you make 100 new friends. We need people to get those petitions from the borough and get signatures here by July 15th. So thanks for the show, and thank you for letting me tell everybody about the petition again.
You bet.
All right. Bye. We are just about at the end of the program here this morning. We've got just a couple of minutes left. If you'd like to call in and participate, the number is 458-TALK, 458-8255. That principle of voting in self-defense, wouldn't it pretty much be no? I mean, how often do you see things on the ballot that are, if you enact this measure, it's going to lead to freedom? I mean, even even this thing that Vivian is talking about with the petition, it is specifically, it forbids the borough from enacting this thing that they have already passed.
Right.
And people may not understand that they already passed severe restrictions on your right to burn wood that will go into effect as soon as the current measure that forbids them from doing so expires.
What's more effective? I'm just thinking about this kind of out loud. Is it more effective to keep passing these things? I mean, because I've only noticed here in the last 3 or 4 years, and every year we have to pass something to stop the borough from banning these things. So if all these people that vote to stop the borough, if they would just let the borough, the law that they pass is going to ban these things, and just told them to stick it up their nose and burn wood and do what they want anyways, I think that's more effective.
Well, again, it comes down to the fact that the borough does not actually have enforcement power.
What if 3,000, I don't know how many signatures we need, but what if those, let's say it's 2 or 3,000 signatures, and let's say it's 20,000 people that vote for, or it's not going to be close to that, 8 or 10,000 people vote for the measure to stop the borough. What if they just refused consent and burned what they wanted? And then when the boroughs, holy moly.
Well, you see, now you start challenging the very concept that most people are law-abiding citizens.
What is a law, though?
You know, I mean, look at how many people completely bow down to...
It's not a legitimate law.
What? I can't text while I'm in the car? Okay, I refuse to... then I will not do that. Okay, I will obey.
Burning what you want is your right.
What? I have to buy more health care and prove that I've got it? Okay, I will do what you say because you have passed a law.
Yeah.
What? I must offer my child to Moloch?
So as long as you
have passed the law, therefore I must comply.
So as long as we go along with the system and participate, and we don't really have any reason to gripe about it, because if we get our if we get this, and nothing against, I know Tammy Wilson and Vivian are, it's fine. I'm all for stopping the borough from taking away our right to burn. But do they have the right to do that in the first place? I don't believe that they do. So if we participate in this and our measure fails, then we've lent legitimacy, saying that the borough does, in fact, majority rule.
Well, that's,
would then
this is why they
over.
Passed the ordinance in the first place that we're trying to that they're trying to stop is because the majority of people tuned out and voted yes, we want local control.
Well, what is
of course, the choice was: do you
right,
want state control or do you want local control?
Josh has got a good point. So for all the people that are screaming and yelling and want this ballot to go through, let's say we do it again. And the people unanimously, I mean, not necessarily unanimously, but majority votes that we should have a ban. So is everybody going to respect that?
Well, they should because we participated in it saying, well, let's throw the coin up. Whoever wins, wins. That's, we will obey if you win. You will obey if we win.
It's the same thing that the judge decided on Obamacare.
Yep.
It's the same concept. And it's why he was right.
Remove consent. Let them pass whatever the law they want and throw a tire on the fire and get warm.
I don't know anybody that would burn a tire.
Yeah, use wood.
All right, we're out of time.
Tires are hotter.
This takes us to the end of Patriot's Lament. Action point today, do not comply.
Remove consent.
All right, we'll see you again next week. Wake up call at 9 a.m.